What is going on, Wolfpack Nation? Hope everybody's doing well this evening. Thank you all so much for joining us here for another edition of the Tuffy Talk Live Show. Again, so excited here to be rolling. As you may see, obviously things are definitely a bit different here today. Yeah, just to kind of give a little bit of insight. So we have actually partnered with a network called the World Sports Broadcasting Network, WSBN. And so now we have actually paired up with them. So now they're able to broadcast our live shows on all of their media outlets, but we can still show them on YouTube, on Facebook, etc., just like normal. Now, the one thing to keep in mind, as you may notice, is that typically you would be able to see the comments on the right side of our screen, which again, so that was through our old system Restream, but now we're on Streamlabs, which is different, doesn't give us quite that capability, but we still we're still able to see comments. And also too, we actually have a couple of new tricks that we're going to be showing off here today as well, that Streamlabs gives us that Restream doesn't give us. So we're definitely looking forward to that. So again, make sure, again, as always, if you want to send us a comment, send us a question, shoot it to us in the comments, and we'll definitely get to it here as soon as we can. But again, first and foremost, I know that obviously we have a lot to get to today, but first and foremost, definitely got to go ahead and address the elephant in the room, for sure. Obviously
what's going on? I don't know what you're talking about.
Yeah, right. I mean, what's going on with that?
I love elephants.
Yeah, I love elephants.
What's new going on?
Yeah, what's new going on? Yeah. Obviously, there's been a lot of stuff going on in social media, from a tweet that was retweeted by Coach Doran. And, I know it's been a whole thing, which we'll kind of get to, but I feel like Ken's that you'd be the right person to kind of take over the situation. and then we'll take over from there.
Before she does that, I really wish they would have done like hashtag Tuffy Talk, because there's no doubt we would have been trending.
Yeah, true. I agree.
No doubt.
Oh. You're muted, Ken.
Hold on, Ken's. Yeah, your mic went. Right.
How come I didn't get money for all these news stations, articles, stuff like that?
Yeah.
I don't understand that.
Welcome to my world. You experienced everything I experienced last year.
Yeah. And Rusty's admitting that using the word celebrity with Ken, so maybe that's a positive thing, celebrity.
Appreciate it. Right.
So we are now we're not both famous, we're both infamous. So
infamous. That's true. Like it. All right, Ken.
Dave Doran, our dynamic duo now.
Yeah.
Throwing that out there.
I mean, I think we're the only two fans that he's ever mentioned in one of his press conferences.
Right, that's what I'm saying.
That's true.
He knows who I am now. That was my goal. But all right, well, obviously, a lot of you probably know the tweet that we're referring to. I'm not going to read it. But first and foremost, I do want to apologize to anyone that was offended by my tweet. I didn't think it was going to get that much attention at all. Before Dave retweeted it, it was like the same usual people that like my tweets or retweet it or comment. So it was nothing big. But I said that's how I met a lot of you, is through my no filter, which I have been working on, and I will continue to work on my passionate self. But rereading it there, I definitely could have and should have gone about it differently and approached the situation differently. But like I said, I do struggle with that. But I do want to say to all the alumni, boosters, fans, like, if you felt attacked, I'm sincerely sorry. Like, I graduated from state, love all of you. Like, I feel like you should know that by now. Love Wolfpack Nation with my entire heart. That was never my intention to upset anyone. But now to the juicy stuff of what I meant when I said that.
Yeah.
All of you know I love NC State, the university, the city, the fans, everything about it. But I'm also one of those fans that you don't see a lot with my optimism all the time. And my craziness, I'll just say that. And that's not something that I like turn on and off before and after a game. So like, that's where that tweet came from. I truly believe that Carter Finley is one of the best atmospheres in the country. I feel like it's one of the hardest places to play for opponents when it's at full force. And I don't know if it's just me being friends with the guys on the team, or the fact that I've heard from them saying that it's hard for them to come out after halftime and see a fourth of the stands gone or half of the stands gone. Like, that kind of not upsets them, but it makes them feel some type of way. So obviously that's what I meant by that tweet. I think that they have shown, especially the teams recently, that they're going to give that never give up mentality, and that if they're doing all that on the field and giving their all, then we should do our part as the 12th man and be there for them as much as, because of how much they're giving to us.
Amen.
And hearing the guys high-fiving after, I don't know if any of y'all got high-fived after the game. It should say a lot to fans that were there. They literally looked at us and said, thank you guys for staying. We appreciate the fans that stayed. Mm-hmm. And that should tell us all we need to hear. But I think it helps recruiting with staying for games. I know recruits probably want to see a full stadium. Like, even if we're, I mean, think of all the big schools around. They don't have empty stadiums. Mm-hmm. And think about the school down the street. We're kind of hypocrites if we're saying that those fans never show up or they leave, and then we're doing the same thing. But I think we're one of the most passionate fan bases in the country, and we need to show that. But I am genuinely sorry, and I hope I didn't change the way a lot of you feel about me, because I know I changed the way some of y'all feel about me. But I do love you guys, and I thank the people that have reached out to me, because with everything going on, plus this, it's been a crazy week. But I'm ready to get back in the Carter on Saturday and get rowdy with y'all, beat Wake, and put all this behind me.
Yep. Absolutely. Yeah, I know, Kenz. Definitely, appreciate you you saying all that. I'm sure I speak on behalf of everybody else, again, I think that none of us question your fanhood is, I think and again, because keep in mind, for everybody that's tuning in, Wolfpack Nation, is at the end of the day, we're sitting here and we've always said the Tuffy Talk is five fans. We're not five media members, we're not five guys that are getting paid to do this. We're not getting paid to do this. We're right now we're paying to do this, just for simply our love, creating NC State content and just really talking NC State athletics and NC State in general. Like, that's why we do this. And obviously with Kenz, we knew coming on that, that she's passionate. She puts it out there for sure. But at the end of the day, keep in mind that, no matter how much, no matter if we agree, disagree, whatever it is, we're all NC State fans. We're all in this together. We all want the same things. We all want championships. We all want wins. We all want to beat the heck out of Carolina. Like, we all want the same things. That's why, no matter what, we're never going to say no. We're never going to push NC State fan away just because they disagree or do this, do that, whatever it be. At the end of the day, we're all Wolfpack Nation. We're all a family, and we're in this together. I mean, again, there's no doubt, and people question all the time, that being NC State fan makes character or builds character. Like, what are you talking about? Like, no, there's no doubt that, anybody who is NC State fan knows that you don't do it because you choose to do it.
It chooses you.
It chooses you. Exactly. It chooses you, Greg. I love that.
That was a perfect way to say that.
I love that. So, but yeah, so again, hopefully we can finally put that all behind us, and move on. And, just at the end of the day, just keep in mind again that I think that for me, and again, I'm curious, anybody else wants to add in here.
But I've got lots of thoughts.
Oh, well then, Greg, please.
Greg, be nice to me.
No, look, if you, we have to be careful how we say this, but if you took exception to what was put out there, maybe you need to look in the mirror. Mm-hmm. Show up. Well, stay there. Look, if you've got other things going on, I get it. There's priorities and, family or whatever. You got to go to work or whatever the case is. I get it. That's the 1% of the fans. Most of those people left. They left because of the score. They didn't leave for any other reason.
Well, and because keep in mind, that was the first thing that was said in that tweet, was that to the fans that left because of the score. We're not talking about the fans that left because they have kids and they have to go to school the next day. We're not talking about kids that have to get up for
and
work.
These podcasts have been dissecting it, like the Giglio and all them, I'm not coming at any of the fans that left because you have work or any of that. I get it.
Read. Yeah. It's fundamental.
If it's solely for the score, then don't come. But other than that, I understand all that.
And especially too, y'all, because keep in mind that, just believe it or not, first of all, we're sitting here 6-2. You know, again, we're going to complain about being 6-2 for about 0.0000 seconds. Like, I don't understand really why there's so much doubt or frustration right now with NC State fans, because then they we're sitting here 6-2 and exactly. Our two losses were against top 20 teams on the road. I mean, so we're and also too, because then they we out of Virginia Tech, there's still a lot of questions that are going into Wake Forest. But the one question which we do have is we have our quarterback for, you know, for probably the rest of the season, as long as he can stay healthy and continue doing building off of what he did, you know, against Virginia Tech and MJ Morris. So that's a great thing to have. That's a huge building block there and a huge scare and a big worry, you know, coming out of Syracuse is what are we going to do with the quarterback position, which I don't know if you know, but it's kind of a big deal for, you know, a football team.
Right.
So I genuinely have a couple of questions.
Go for it.
How does it matter how you get to the end score? Right. The end result is what ultimately matters in this game. So, mm-hmm. So what if it takes you 59 minutes to figure it out? What if it takes you 45 minutes to figure out? Like, what does it matter? You got the end result. You figured it out. You found a way. You triumphed. You beat your opponent. And that's what you want. Like, does it matter how you got there?
Well, and again, keep in mind, y'all, that I could point to many different games. Pitt in 2020, Duke in 2020, UNC last year, you know, obviously Virginia Tech this past week, where you've seen State dig themselves out of a hole, and against teams that are ACC teams. I mean, we're not talking about digging out of a hole against Richmond. We're talking about digging out of a hole against an ACC opponent, which everybody says, well, you beat the last place team in the Coastal.
Yeah, but guess what we didn't do this weekend? We didn't lose to UConn.
That's true too. Yeah, we didn't lose to UConn. So, yeah, no, he got a little there. So again, there's no doubt that the program has changed, has developed for the better. There's no doubt about it. And because we're sitting here going into the season, we were thinking this has to be the year, because after this year, we're losing a ton. Well, I can literally say MJ Morris, Terrell Timmons, Demi Sumo, Michael Allen and all these young guys, you know, they're young guys that are going to give us even great seasons for the next while, for at least next year or two, at least. And then, you know, Dorn's going to bring in boys, you know, Kevin Concepcion, you know, all these recruits that are committed right now to continue their legacy. So, Macon, you've been quiet so far, man. What are your thoughts?
I mean, you know, I think we might be making a mountain out of a molehill kind of thing here. But I mean, I'm okay with the passion and that kind of thing. I think you'd rather Doran, in this case, care than not care.
Amen.
And I value that. I don't take it as him being like a slap in the face of the fans. I think Greg made a great point about the score. That's what I feel about it. I think if you're a fan, that the players need you there. Not just when it's like everything's smooth sailing. It needs to be there when it's like, you know, how true a fan are you? If it's only like, oh, if we're only up by like two scores in the first half, then I'll stay. Because there's some fans out there that if you're winning, they'll leave too. So, I mean, a fan has a right to their ticket. They bought their ticket. They can leave whenever they want to. But, I mean, I kind of feel like Dave Doran he's fair to just kind of say what he wants to say about it without – and all he didn't even really say anything personal until his press conference about it. So,
I mean, he really basically I'm the dirty guy. Like I'm the one that said it. I'm his person that if he needs something to be said, come to me. Like Dave, I will say what he needs to be said. I promise. Yeah. So just hire me.
I don't like fans leaving. I don't like fans leaving early. I think it's a big problem. We've been talking about it for years with handouts and things like that. But I mean, like McKenzie said and Layton said, this is not about fans who have to go back to work. It's a Thursday night game. I get it. And you have kids. I get it. It's a late night game. I mean, Thursday nights are always late night games. But I just don't – I feel like if we – it kind of goes in the same vein of with donors where it's like, oh, well, give me something to root for and then I'll start donating. It's like, well – if you're not really interested in doing that after the last few years, we've been like 9-win seasons and almost a 10-win season. and 15 straight home games on the verge to tie. The record is 16, right? So we could tie the record Saturday.
And then potentially beat it the next Saturday.
Right. And maybe they're waiting for an ACC championship. And we've discussed about, you know, would you rather be an NC State or a Syracuse where they had the one huge season, or maybe the two, maybe this season now is like another big season for them, but everything else has been like four wins. Really bad. I mean, they almost wanted to fire Dina Babers. Would you rather be that and have one amazing season, or be consistent and be like a nine wins team and always in that conversation right there? And at some point, hopefully you break through. I'd rather be that team. And I just think, you know, fans are going to be fans. They have the right to their ticket, but I don't like seeing fans leave early. If it was a noon game and people wanted to leave at 2:00, 2:30, I wouldn't like that. If it was a 3:30 game, people left at 6:00. I wouldn't really like that. The game's not over. Even, I mean, there's a lot of games that State has come back. Obviously the Virginia Tech game, but you look at that Maryland game back in 2012. Mm-hmm. I'm trying to think, you guys help me out here. Some
Florida
other games.
State.
Florida State game, right, where we was down 16-0, I think it was.
Yep.
Florida State, you know, this year.
Florida State this year is a great point. Yeah, I just think there's a lot of instances where, I mean, you're called Cardiac Pack for the reason, and buy into that. Be there, support them. They, you know, they can, if they're up by three scores, I mean, they don't need the fans as much, in my opinion. I mean, the time, if you are to leave, in my opinion, it's when you're up, right? Because then you're like, you're winning big. That would be the time to leave, in my opinion. But when they're down, they need you. They need that. Right. They need a little bit of motivation.
Exactly. That's so, how I feel about it. Like, if we all just leave, like, well, how's that comeback going to come? Like, we're not really the 12th man if everybody's gone. Like,
well,
you haven't lost the game by halftime, right? So, I mean, like, unless it's like, you know,
we're winning the game at halftime.
Well, unless it's like 48-0. I mean,
yeah, I mean, we got the late touchdown in the third quarter, so we had narrowed the gap, but it was 18 with about 5 minutes left in the third quarter. So,
yeah,
You just never know. That's why I don't leave games. So,
but let's end this. Let's wrap the bow on this. Hey, name all those names again that you said, all those young kids, just one more time.
Demi Sumo, MJ Morris, Terrell Timmons, Michael Allen.
So if I can take a song from the 80s, our future is so bright, we have to wear shades. So let's go, all right? Like, we're good. We're good. Yeah. We're good.
Yep. Again, Dorn's got this program going in the right direction, y'all. I mean, there was a tweet put out today by Brett McMurphy that was provided by Mike Tracy, saying that we're actually have the fifth longest streak right now of consecutive rankings in the college football playoff rankings. So,
I know that. So I saw somewhere else that said State has one of the best winning, the most, one of the best, they're the program that's had one of the most wins in the country without being in the playoff. And you're talking 72. Like the teams, you're talking like with teams with Penn State, USC, Wisconsin. Some really honorable programs, some high profile programs, and you're right there. And there really weren't any in that list that were like, you know, Vanderbilt's or anything like that, or Missouri. It was like legit name programs. So Dave Dorn's got doing this right. I think fans, if this is the one thing that he's done as a personal note that bothers you, I would just say forgive the guy and let it go. I mean, but
Yep. So I think, you know, 20 minutes in is enough to kind of wrap the bow on that for sure. Again, I mean, know, obviously, again, Wake Forest sold out prime time, 8 p.m. You know, so it's going to be a happening, crazy environment. The red lights are going to be glowing in Carter Finley. And hopefully we got we're going to have a crowd there that's going to be spectacular to help these guys pull off what can be a huge, huge win for Coach Dorn and his staff. So one of the next things which I wanted to do, you know, to kind of show off some more about our capabilities is, so I wanted to first show off, you know, obviously we talked about MJ Morris, you know, obviously, you know, blew up in the, you know, late third quarter heading into the fourth quarter for Virginia Tech last year. Wanted to show off this one clip here, which obviously is the clip that, I mean, I think all of us can just, gorgeous.
I'm telling you right now, man, like I was up there in the stands and me and some of the fans up there were talking, and I for that particular play, I was where that was in the game. I was like, they need to take a shot right here. And coincidentally, they did. And my all was like, yeah, that's right. You called it. Yeah. They've been like calling up, turning around to the box and taunting Tim Beck up to that point. But man, that was sweet. That was a sweet throw.
This is the drive where I was with some folks and, you know, everyone was down. And I'm like, look, we get a score right here. We're right back in it. And like two plays later, they throw this. Yep. And I'm like, I told you, let's go.
It's gorgeous. Let's go. Gorgeous throw. Yeah. So again, it there's no doubt that MJ has all the arm talent and then some. You know, again, even for Mike Glennon himself, again, one of the greatest quarterbacks NC State's had, to say that even from the quarter and a half that MJ Morris played, that he was blown away by the decision making, by the throws that MJ Morris was making, that's got to say a ton within itself. It's got to.
I think it's just more so, again, that we talk about this, you know, on a different show, an episode that's coming out at some point. But the fact that he was doing it when you knew he had a throw to score and come back, and that he's a true freshman, he did 3 touchdowns in like a half of football. I mean, that's probably he was doing those things when the defense knew what they were going to have to do to score. He's a true freshman, and he comes in and he does that. Having to make those kind of throws more, I feel like even at times being able the ability to make them, but also like that he had to do it in that situation was what was impressive to me also.
Yeah. And by the way, Greg, Hunter Smith says slap the Tuffy Talk logo on those shades and sell them. So
the fact that he saved he was put into a crazy position. We're down that many to like statistically the worst team in the ACC this year. And home field record is on the line, true freshman. Like, I just think like he's a beast. Like, for him to be able to come in and do that, like, he is our QB1
now. And I will say this, I feel like he obviously, the depth chart was released, he is the starter. For those who didn't see that, he is not even co-starter, he is the starter. I noted this. I do feel like you're excited about it, and I'm excited about it. I think
gotta
a little
build
bit
on it.
Yeah, but I think you got to build on. But I do think he's a little bit of like pump the brakes because he isn't just a true freshman, and that was only like one half of football against that team, right? So I just say when he pumped the brakes a little bit, like he's going to make mistakes probably,
but
so,
it's encouraging.
But man, there's so much there in that regard, and it's like there's hope in that regard. Like this season may not be over, kind of thing. So
I just thought he was really good in his decision making. Like he knew where he wanted to go with the ball, and his release was nice. Like it didn't look like a freshman. I will say that, right? And then like
it looked poised for a true freshman.
Absolutely. Yeah. He got out of the pocket when he needed to, you know, he did what he had to do. Yeah. Go ahead, Michael.
That's what I was gonna say. I like he moved around the pocket well. I mean, it helped that the O line was really, really good in the second half.
Yeah, I think he took one sack, right? I think he took like one sack in that.
Yeah,
yeah, but that was on a blitz. So
yeah, but most of the time, and when they did get pressure, he avoided it and I think we're all impressed.
By the way, welcome back, Devin Carter.
Yes. DC. No. And again, we've talked about this, but, I think that one of the most impressive things to me was that once MJ Morris started to flow, the whole team flowed with him.
Agreed.
Devin Carter started rolling. Finally. Holy crap, we started rolling.
I feel like
the defense started rolling. Go ahead.
I feel like the GIF where the Undertaker comes out of his coffin. That should be a thing with Devin Carter's face on it.
Yes.
That'd be a good one.
Yeah. But no.
And you brought up a good point, Leighton. Like the defense showed out. Like I think I didn't look at the sacks stats. We might have equaled our season sacks in that game.
100%.
Well,
Wilson went off.
I think it was 4. Yeah. I think it was 4.
So
that game.
It was close then.
So from the moment that MJ threw that first touchdown to Thayer, Virginia Tech had a total of -4 yards of offense.
They had that in the fourth quarter, right? They had it in the whole fourth quarter, I think.
Yeah. Well,
essentially the fourth quarter.
Yeah.
I mean, we had like a minute left.
Yeah. So, McLean Hardy, and this kind of brings up kind of one next question I want to talk about a little bit here. McLean Hardy brings up a comment saying, no hate to Leary, but I haven't seen a ball placed that perfect in too long. And, obviously Leary up until, he got injured, seemed to be off. Now Clemson, again, I always go back to Clemson. He looked solid to me. Like, was he, did he look like, the Devin of last year? sort of, but you know, just again, he's been a little bit off. But that kind of brings up my next question, because I know that's what everybody's saying. Because for those who don't know, Devin Leary had a press conference today, basically just saying that, you know, basically just kind of touching base on his season-ending injury, and then you know, basically the big comment out of it all was basically that he hasn't made a decision yet in terms of if he's going to return next season or not. And keep in mind, because it is a possibility that when he says coming back or not, that doesn't necessarily mean about going to the draft or coming back to state. Yep. It could be,
yeah,
it could be unfortunately transferring, you know, which is, you know, I'm not saying that I suspect that. I'm not saying I hope for that at all. I'm just saying that's a possibility. So go ahead.
Let me ask you guys about that, because
yeah, that's a big comment. That's a big question.
Well, here's my thing is, why do you think he did that press conference? Because
I thought it was weird too.
It was like, I want to give a call or press conference to give you no update.
Yeah, basically no news. Right.
Why do you think he did that?
Let me
motivation. There's no news, but I'm going to call a press conference.
Maybe just to get ahead of it, to stop speculation.
Yeah, I think that people are already all over like social media saying that he's leaving, and I think that he was trying
to leave.
I haven't made a decision yet.
Yeah,
that's probably the most logical reason. Just like you said, just to get ahead of it and just to quell the rumors for at least one more week.
Yeah.
Well, see, did he? I can't even watch it. Did he say like his arm's recovering on track or it feels good or whatever? What was he saying?
Yeah.
Go ahead, Michael.
He just said he's taking it day to day, but it was going well.
No answers.
Big nothing burger. Like, it sounds like
it could take up to 6 months for him to be fully healed.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. No. So again, because I think that's the biggest thing, and because everybody's saying you know, oh well, if MJ Morris balls out, then he's definitely going to be the starter next year. You know, period. Which you know, the big thing, which I want to say is once again. One game at a time, one season at a time. Let's not think about necessarily next season. But at the end of the day, the one thing which I will say is, luckily enough, you know, for all of Wolfpack Nation, we don't have to make that decision. If MJ Morris does ball out and Devin Leary does decide to come back, then we're not the ones that has to make that decision. Then that's up to Coach Dorn and his staff to make that decision. But I can guarantee you that he would much rather have to make the decision between starting Devin Leary or MJ Morris if MJ Morris starts out next year. Than to not have that. Like he would rather have that choice, period, between two great quarterbacks. So, but again, just one step at a time. Let's see what happens with MJ first. Let's focus on Wake Forest.
Let's focus on this season. Let's not worry about.
And then we'll go from there.
Yeah.
So way too much speculation ahead.
I just don't want this to turn into like a Russell Wilson and Mike Glennon situation.
I told you last week.
Well, because the funny thing too is that, so, you know, obviously with O'Brien, Mike Glennon more fit the offense that Tom O'Brien wanted to run.
I know, Lane. I know you're going.
MJ Morris runs more of the offense.
But hey, but at the same time, if you want to go that way,
yeah,
you know, Russell Wilson became something and Mike Glennon
again
had a good career, but
I'm not saying
I told you apples to oranges though.
But I look at a guy who I've seen throw 35 touchdowns, and I've seen basically get to 10 wins, and I've seen all that. Break records, tie records.
Yep.
I'm rolling with that guy until he doesn't want to play anymore.
I love him.
I'm team Leary.
I'm team Leary.
I don't think state fans should be any
whoever gets us the W. I got no allegiance.
I just love Leary.
If you don't know what you don't know.
I just want everyone to have a good time.
Well, and keep in mind too that I'm not saying that they should pick MJ. I'm just saying it's kind of creepy how much of a similarity is potentially.
It's a lesser version. I think it's a lesser version of it. We don't know. I mean, it may become nothing, but I just am like, I don't want this to become a. Go ahead.
And that decision is because it's going to be Leary's decision, really. Before that was Tom O'Brien telling Russell Wilson, like, we're going to make a decision with or without you. So.
Right. Exactly.
But it will be interesting to see how it plays out.
Right. Mm-hmm. Yep. So McLean, definitely stay tuned on that. Let's take care of one game at a time here. But moving on to the next clip I wanted to kind of discuss. So this play to me, the Peyton Wilson play, was a play that I watched multiple times. And that's so stupid.
It makes me so mad watching it again.
Well,
rest just makes me so mad.
Well, see, here's my thing. All right. So I feel like that the problem with Peyton Wilson is that first of all, he's a bulldog. That dude is a beast. He is an animal. Like, and he never stops. He just goes. So I feel like in this situation, ideally, which I get it. See, he brings him in. You would have asked Peyton Wilson to stop pulling right there when he obviously knows I am 5 yards out of bounds. So don't follow through. But now, I mean, obviously, it's still a borderline in my head. And definitely as a State fan, I'm like, you know, it's a borderline.
He was trying to drop him, but he kind of dropped him a little hard.
Little too much. Yeah. Little too much. You know, if again, it was more of the follow through with the aggressive follow through that really, I think, is what pulled the flag. Because, I mean, especially when the guy goes flying into the benches, it's like, okay, I get it. But, you know, it's a hard play. I mean, that's what I'm saying. I'm not going to really sweat too much Peyton Wilson about it, but just something to keep in mind for when he does decide to go pro, that at the end of the day, you can't leave it up to chance. You know, you got to know where you are and you got to make the best decision based on the situation you're in. Go ahead, Michael.
At the same time, the quarterback tried to stay in bounds to get more yards. So like, I don't know. He's not giving himself up.
No, he stopped.
It's like, I get it. It's going to be, they're going to call that probably 9 times out of 10 because of the little extra throw at the end, but it's dumb.
Yep. Nope. I agree.
It's all right. Draco bailed us out.
Hey, amen.
Well, and Peyton Wilson got a big sack, I think, on the next drive.
I kind of feel like Peyton sometimes is still, I don't know if you guys feel the way, I still feel like there's a little bit of rawness with him. He's not played a whole season, you know, when he got hurt last time, and he got hurt half, I think, I know another point, and it was, you know, I feel like there's plays where he's maybe some dialing it in. He's still trying to figure out. Mm-hmm. I don't know if you guys get that vibe, but he has so much athleticism and so much potential that he just kind of needs to dial it in here and there.
Feels like Tanner Engel.
Yeah, I think sometimes he's just so fat. I think he's so fast he overruns the play. He doesn't break down, you know, and stop and square up and get like, the guy.
Like with DJ Uiagalelei on that last drive, he just he didn't close in and get a good angle, and then DJ just went right around him.
Yeah,
to seal the game.
It's almost like he's too aggressive, if that makes sense. Like he comes in really hard, and then he just
he's aggressive.
Yeah. Now Christian Jones comes in and says softest call ever. So
that's exactly what I set up where I was like, that's so soft. I was like, that is such a soft call.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, I mean, you could definitely tell he was trying to let go, but he just, you know, he's a big dude.
He was letting go after he full blown threw that guy into the
bench. But he was carrying through the play that was started in bounds. I mean, like you can't just stop the play. I mean, you have to finish it, you know, and it just took a little too far. But
I know.
Again, man, what are we doing here? We won. Exactly.
I know. Well, and just again, that was one play that just kept on. Like even after the game, I was like, I need to go watch that back. Like what was that? What happened? So you know, just want to kind of get some thoughts on that. Now the one thing which I do first of all, Wolfpack Crazy. What's up? What's up, Wolfpack Crazy?
What up?
What up? That old commercial. That's such a funny commercial. What up?
So this
Greg's
next
glasses made that perfect.
I mean, again, we just need the Greg's glasses with Tuffy Talk logos on them, and then we're really rocking. Oh, I see you, Greg. Yeah, sir.
it's really bright now with these lights.
So the last clip I wanted to bring up was actually not a play because of the catch. This was actually the Terrell Timmons drop. But to me, I feel like this is one that, dude has so much.
He's
like,
going
to
be good.
Like one thing that stood out to me is there's like a still shot of like from the side that you see the sideline and seeing like all the people's faces with Terrell Timmons in the air is like, they're all like, oh my god!
He tracked
it well,
though. I mean, he tracked both of those balls really well.
Like, look at his. Oh man, so good.
It was, he didn't drop the ball because anything the defender did. He probably got
the wind knocked out of him when he
got down. Dude, like, I remember when he was recruited, he was a 3-star guy, and I can't remember who his other offers were, but he was injured his senior year, and he was rehabbing, and I remember seeing a clip of him sprinting, like doing like a 40, and I think he had like a 4.3 kind of 40, and it was, I mean, he was moving for a guy his length, and I feel like maybe the only reason why they haven't played him is because either one, they're giving better veteran guys playing time, or two, he doesn't know the whole route tree at this point, but if he can be in there and learn, if he can learn one or two more routes so he can keep a defender honest, that would be great, because he flashed a lot more on those deep balls than any receiver has to this point this season.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
1,000%.
Completely agree.
He's got the frame for it. I mean, he's 6'2".
Oh, yeah.
And like that, just the way his body control there on that last play to just turn around and find the ball.
It was great technique.
I'm going to add this too. There was a tweet that was going out, I think, like a day or two after the game. MJ Morris, Terrell Timmons, Michael Allen were all in that same recruiting class.
Yeah.
So that could be a turn into a really good recruiting class for State by like the early returns, I guess is the way to put it.
Yep. Well, and that kind of leads us perfectly into our first tweet of the week. So with that being said, we're going to jump on to our toughest tweets of the week, baby. All right, so our first tweet of the week, not to, you know, say is our tweet, because, man, first of all, I love this graphic, but
first tweet of the week is us.
First tweet of the week.
Well, take that.
Hey, you know, when I'm proud of a graphic, I'm going to show it off a little bit. That's what I'm saying, okay? So, obviously, here you have pictured, for those listening to us, you have MJ Morris, Terrell Timmons, and Demi Sumo. And all it says at the bottom is the future. And obviously, first thing, which I actually loved, was people commenting saying, well, what about Michael Allen? What about, you know, Dylan Julian Van? Gray. What about, you know, Julian Gray? What about those guys? It's like, hey, listen, first of all, then they, I mean.
That's not an issue at all. Just
I
keep mean, adding.
Well, that's what I'm saying. That's why I'm like, I love it. I love that we should add more people to this graphic. But then they, I mean. Obviously, I wanted to go, you know, quarterback, running back, wide receiver, just keep it simple. And at the end of the day, I mean, Demi Sumo, believe it or not, a lot of people say, I thought he's a redshirt freshman. Nope, he's a true sophomore. You know, didn't have a redshirt last year because of special teams. But then, I mean, Terrell Timmons has really started to stand out. And then obviously, MJ Morris has been dynamite.
I'm going to add something, too. You want to talk about young names. I think it was Thunder Dan who put out something that was saying how players who have impressed and from the development team or the practice squad, whoever it is, I think there was three other guys he was saying that their time's going to come, but I think it was Torin Wright, Brandon Cleveland, and Dejon Thompson. Those are guys in that class that were, I've read somewhere, I think it was Thunder Dan tweet, was talking about those guys being, their time will come. They've impressed, so.
Yep. Yep.
That class looks like it's going to be a pretty good class for State.
Well, and McLean asked the question, why has he been on scout? Why has Terrell Timmons been on scout team all year with the wide receiver struggles we have felt? And I mean,
we didn't expect to have that.
We didn't expect it. Yeah, no, exactly. I mean, you have Porter Rooks, you know, Thayer Thomas, Devin Carter, you know, Julian Gray, who stepped up, Keon Lassane, Anthony Smith, you know, obviously Darryl got knocked Jones. Out, you know, Darryl Jones. So, I mean, you shouldn't have to have Terrell Timmons. I mean, you know, ideally you would like to redshirt him and keep him on scout team, but you know, with obviously Anthony Smith being knocked out for the season, then Julian Gray, Devin Carter going through some struggles, Porter Rooks going through some struggles. It's like, okay, well, let's bring up Terrell and see what happens. And cause that's Dave Dorn actually addressed that, saying that's why we brought him in, because we needed another explosive option with Anthony Smith going out for the season. So that's why we brought in Terrell Timmons.
His other offers for Timmons were, I'm reading here, Elon, James Madison, A&T, and Rhode Island. Those were his offers besides State.
So like only it. Power five.
Yep. Yeah.
Wow.
We've had like some success with some guys who've been only power five offers. Jalen Samuels.
Sure. Yeah.
Well, Russell Wilson.
Where's he from?
Greensboro. Timmons is from Greensboro.
Well, and J-Sam only had one other offer, so even crazier that guy only had one offer. But
we're talking about one half of football again. Be mindful of that. So.
Yes, but at the end of the day,
he only had two catches.
We see
don't
the potential.
Burst my bubble. Okay,
we see the potential. That's all we're saying. We see the potential, folks.
But I think that's really what the crux of this is. Is look, we've struggled in some areas through the season, but the cupboard is not bare. Like there's more coming, and you know our recruiting class moving forward is going to be able to complement previous recruiting classes. So look, let's not get down on this team. And we've been saying it. There's still plenty of football. I mean, we still have what, four games left?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. When and Syracuse right, and Wake losing. I mean,
yeah, there's a lot still on the table. Absolutely. So now moving on to our next tweet of the week is the announcement of the college football playoff rankings, where NC State comes in at number 22. So again, in the AP poll, we're 21. College Football Playoff came in at 22. You know, Wake Forest is at 21. So you got number 21 this weekend versus number 22. You know, so I mean, it's, I feel like that's pretty fair. I mean, you know, honestly, because I mean, especially since the College Football Playoff, this is their first poll. You know, they could go all kinds of different ways. They could, you know, have put us, you know, a good bit higher. They could have not ranked us, but I feel like that 22 for me, I was like, okay, good. I like it. And also too, because my number throughout my, you know, the youth years was 22. So I'm like, I like 22. I like that number.
Can we take a second? Like, there's some non-traditional teams on here that have not been playing well the last 5 to 8 years. Like, you have UCLA. Like,
UNC.
UNC.
Oregon State. Syracuse. Like, I mean, there's some programs that
Alabama,
you know, yeah, Texas.
I don't even know what that, what is that A logo? I've never seen that before.
Yeah.
But no, anyway, I just thought it was, you know, kind of refreshing there.
Yeah. Funny. But Illinois up at 16. That's that's a shocker for sure.
There's a state coach there. Was it the receiver?
George McDonald.
George McDonald.
Mm-hmm. And then Devin's brother Donovan Leary is there. Yeah,
and then what's his name?
Aaron Henry.
Thank you. Yep, Aaron Henry.
And then Calvin Hart, former in-state linebacker,
transferred there. Yep.
Transferred to Illinois.
And then Devin Leary's brother is there too.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yep.
Yeah. So and true. I think the running back leads the nation in rushing yards. The Illinois running back.
Yep. So you know, I mean, just wanted to kind of throw that out there to see if there's any comments. But I mean, pretty plain and simple. Sounds good. Looking
still a lot of football.
It. Still a lot of football to be played. Exactly.
No mentality.
Yep. And don't worry too, Dennis, we're going to be talking more about the Wake Forest game here once we get through a couple of more things here. So first of all, crazy news today. Naeem Hines going to the Buffalo
Bills.
He's
going to play more. I'm so excited.
And then Bradley Chubb going to the Miami Dolphins. I mean, for NC State fans, definitely blockbuster trades. Because first of all, you know, it's crazy that two Pac pros are getting as much national publicity about a trade. You know, so that's really cool. But
same
also
recruiting class too.
Yeah, same.
I think they were.
No,
they were.
Bradley Chubb was in Pac 13. Naeem was in Pac 14.
Oh, I thought they were the 15. Same one. Okay.
Whatever. So, but still, I mean, they played together. So that's an important thing. But, I mean, also, Jimmy, because I think this is huge because they're both going to way better situations than they were in. I mean, they're both Super Bowl contender teams now. You know, I mean, especially, you know, Naeem Hines. I mean, he's going to be competing for some major RB1 possible usage. You know, depending on
Bills are probably the favorite for the Super Bowl right now, right?
I would say so. The AFC side, obviously, it's the Eagles and the NFC, but yeah.
So, and then Bradley Chubb going to the Dolphins. Now, obviously, he has to go compete against, you know, guys like former Clemson defensive lineman Christian Wilkins, etc. So, a little bit of smack talk there, I'm sure, which I'll take it. But again, definitely congrats. And, you know, I'm sure, you know, Naeem and Chubb are excited to, you know, go and, you know, compete for a Super Bowl.
That's definitely on the table for these guys. I know Naeem's probably excited about going to compete for a Super Bowl, but going to play from Indiana Dome to Buffalo outside in that winter. Woo!
A little different.
Isn't Buffalo planning on building a facility?
Yeah, they're trying to. Mm-hmm. But then you have Bradley doing the opposite, right? Going from cold Denver to warm Miami. So, and he's going after really the hot part of the year. So it's going to be comfortable down there.
Right.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
And then, end game. Kevin Concepcion had multiple offers, not just one, besides State, had a lot of offers. Major four-star recruit.
Concepcion had like 20 or 30. Like he had a lot.
He was big. So just pushing on there. Huge, huge, hugely excited for those guys and excited for what's to come. So now, obviously, first of all, happy Halloween to everybody. Hope everybody had an awesome Halloween. And just in case, too, you know, for next year, if you're looking for a costume, we always got the crazy NC State fan jumping, you know, breaking his leg costume. Again, it is included a team shirt, team hat.
I kind of look familiar. Leg,
but it does include a stretcher, EMTs, titanium rod. And four screws. And yes, it says Strether.
Yeah, but I misspelled Strether. I was trying to get it out because I was like in a hurry. Yeah.
You know what? It kind of makes it even more legit because you know these things have typos in them. So
yeah, that's true. Look, that's true. there was no spell check on the meme generator. So I apologize. Yeah. I did graduate from high school only, but I did furnish first. but it was in summer school and there was only three of us. So anyway.
Yeah. Yeah. No, exactly. So got to give them credit for that. So now giving a huge shout out to our 2022 ACC champion women's cross country team, who's right now ranked number one in the country. Good. Again, the building a, I think the one word you can say to this is dynasty, folks. Like
it's like, beyond dynasty. That's seven in a row.
In a row.
Like,
yeah.
Like we're like the Alabama of cross country.
Track and field for girls cross country, right? It's like
better than Alabama.
Yeah, I mean, Alabama's not even in the top five.
We just got to win a couple more national championships, you know, to legitimize that. But I mean, yeah, I mean, seven straight conference championships is ridiculous. And then obviously, huge shout out to Caitlin Toohey, who's been absolutely dominant this season.
And we finished 1-2 in the race.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. But we had both first and second place and I think fourth, runners were ours.
And I think fourth. So,
yeah, it's been pretty dominant for sure. Let's put it that way. But again, you know, to see NC State number one in the women's cross country top 25 is huge. So huge hats off to all those girls and the coaching staff and the team. And, you know, again, got to give a hats off even to Debbie Al, you know, for bringing that coach staff in. And man, it's paid off. It's paid off dividends.
I don't remember the coach's name, and I'm sorry for that. But I actually watched the race Friday morning, and when they brought up, you know, the coach's information, she's been with the program for 31 years in some capacity. She was a national champion. I mean, she's really built a great, great program. So, whoever you know got her involved in the program, hats off to them. She is a legend. She should be in the NC State Hall of Fame if she's not already.
Yeah, or head in that direction for sure.
Yeah, for sure.
Absolutely. So the last tweet, which we want to kind of share, you know, which love this from Matt Berry, who called the NC State
Anytime
game.
Anytime we can use that Carolina graphic.
Yeah, yeah, right.
So for those listening in, so this tweet is from Matt Berry, who's one of the commentators for the NC State Virginia Tech game, who also commentated with Dan Mullen. But he said, I've called two NC State football games within the last year. Below are the opportunity win probabilities in the fourth quarter. NC State won both college football.
Period. He better be back on Saturday. And
yeah.
Unfortunately,
no kidding.
He won't.
Yeah, so what you're saying is he should call every single game.
Every single game we want Matt Berry.
He won't be because he does the studio show. So he only does the Thursday night games. So, but if we could get up a GoFundMe and get a solid,
yeah,
special
man, that UNC one, it's like jumping off a cliff. It's so funny, it's so hilarious. Yeah, but it's like, don't do it. Don't do it. You have so much to live for.
if anyone's ever watched that that game on Price is Right, where the little Mountaineer guy goes up and you go like,
and then he just
Yeah,
that's hilarious.
Yeah, for those listening in, there that just to kind of keep in mind, Greg, I'll let you go. Yeah, Matt Berry's showing both the win probability charts that ESPN provides for each game for the Virginia Tech game this past Thursday and then the UNC game last year. Go ahead, Greg.
No, I was just gonna say we need to figure out a way to animate that the Carolina one and tie that little mountain guy into it, and that would think that would be the greatest, 8 seconds of internet
like
history.
Bob Saget next to it, like that, or whatever. That'd be hilarious.
Yeah.
Or is it
Bob Saget?
Bob Saget, right?
No. It used to be.
What's the guy's Drew name? Carey. I can't remember his name.
Bob Barker.
Drew Carey or Bob Barker. 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 It's so long, man. It's different Bob. Different
Bob Saget. He's a tall comedian.
All right, I have two strikes tonight.
Yeah. So with that being said, Macon, we appreciate you joining us.
Hey, give us your all-time NC State basketball coach, real quick.
All time is easy. All time is Jimmy V.
All time,
right?
Fantasy.
All time.
Yeah.
Do I have first pick or do I have the pick I had?
Yeah. For those, and that might be a great plug right here. So if you haven't already, check out our NC State member. I'm sorry, NC State, our Tuffy Talk memberships. Again, for only $1.99 a month, you get access to exclusive Tuffy Talk content, exclusive videos you can only see by being a member. So again, only $1.99 a month. You also get access to our private Discord channel, our weekly newsletter put together by the one and only Michael Tracy, who does an amazing job with that newsletter. And also you get to see, so we did a NC State men's basketball fantasy draft, which was harder than I could ever imagine, for sure. You know, it's not like fantasy football where you have like the little ESPN, you know, predetermined, you know, this is maybe who you should pick. Like, no, it was just like pulling names out of a hat. And yes, I had a pretty crazy pick, and you know, Macon did too, which I appreciate because it helped me
much worse.
A lot.
Macon,
I don't know. I at the end of the day, it is what it is. It was a lot of fun. So
I made all good picks.
I think you and I were in that championship game.
Yeah, right.
That's fair.
So, you know, I think kind of, and first of all, too, I do want to even mention as well that here, right before we end the show, we are going to be picking the winner of the Tuffy Talk Jimmy V fundraiser ticket giveaway. So again, that was for two tickets to the game. That was for a parking pass, an opportunity to come join us for our tailgate with food and drink, and also to an invitation to join us here on the Tuffy Talk live show to talk NC State athletics here with the crew. So again, a huge package. Want to say thank you to everybody who has donated. We have actually, between last year's donations and this year's donations, put together over $1,100 towards the Jimmy V Foundation, which is awesome, definitely. So huge round of applause, and thank you all for donating and helping share the words. Again, just awesome to see us putting together, you know, such a great attendance in terms of from a dollars perspective towards obviously a great cause. So again, make sure to stay tuned for that. We'll be doing that here in a minute. But obviously, I know everybody's, you know, want to talk about this Wake Forest game, which is, you know, a huge game this season for sure. A lot of questions still going into it, you know, but the one thing which I do want to say, I know that I think it was Dennis. I'm trying to find here he goes. Dennis says, I think if we can sack Hardman a couple of times and get a bunch of hurries, our defense can take care of the rest. Hopefully our offense can stay on the field long enough to give our defense a breather. So, you know, I wanted to kind of bring that up first by saying, I feel like, and again, keep in mind that we did NC State versus Wake Forest preview. Those episodes will coming out here this week. So make sure to stay tuned for that. And also, if you see in the banner, make sure to subscribe to Tuffy Talk and hit that like button, hit that notification bell, so you're notified whenever we release those episodes, so you don't miss those. Those are going to be much watches, but we'll kind of do a little bit of a preview here. But you know, that's a huge key, and that's something we talked about a lot, but definitely pressure is going to be huge. Like, you know, yeah. I know one clip that we kind of said, you know, from the Remember the Titans movie, where can't remember the coach's name, it's not Coach Boone, it's the other guy, you know, says, you're gonna blitz all night, and I feel like that's got to be us this week. It's got to be.
Maybe we drop that as a clip. Maybe we drop that as a clip this week.
Maybe
like you did for Clemson.
Maybe. Ken, sorry, go ahead.
No, you're fine. I said Louisville literally showed us how to beat them.
Yeah, like, they really.
So I think that we definitely can.
I'll use this phrase. I'll use it. Louisville embarrassed them. I mean, it was bad. Them. So bad. I don't know if the situation is sometimes as good for State when you're having to play a team that's getting embarrassed like that. They want to get right, but I agree. I think they need a blitz. You're going to hear that in my preview, in our preview. So I think that's going to be a big part of
pressure
it.
Pressure the yep. entire time.
It's one of those funky offenses where you have to be patient. You have to mind your gaps, you know, be disciplined. Don't get lulled, and then just be sound.
Gotta our
be sound.
Corners need to be ready for push-offs.
Because
their wide receivers push off every game. Be ready for it.
And get off the field on third down. They killed us last year on third down. Like they were like 60-70% on third and fourth down.
Now, the kind of thing which, you know, I feel like is a little bit of an annoying factor, you know, which I mean, again, hats off to Sam Hardman again. I mean, he's obviously a great guy. I have no issues with him, you know, in terms of from a personal perspective, obviously, again, I mean, there's no doubt he's a talented quarterback and, you know, and I mean, has been, but Sam Hardman is only one touchdown away from breaking Phillip Rivers' career touchdowns.
He's going to do it inside 95. Clark Finley.
That's what I mean. I know. I'm like, oh my gosh.
No, he's going to break that record. Football the entire game.
Yeah. Or is he?
Is
he? He totally is. Yeah.
This is his fifth year, right?
Phillip Rivers
was only here for 4 years. So, like,
but records are records. I know. Records are records, though.
Technically, it doesn't count.
Yeah.
I mean, let's just not even put him on the list. Right? Just stop it right there at 9-4.
And Ted Brown is still the all-time rushing leader, but...
Yes, exactly.
With the way ETN football's going, he may keep that record. People just...
Maybe.
Run the ball.
Yeah. No, absolutely.
Well, that and he played in like 20 bowl games.
True. True. That is true. And, you know, definitely, again... So that's definitely a salty, you know, point for sure. You know, that could potentially happen, which, you know, hey, if it does, then so be it. But then hopefully we can pay him back by not giving him the victory to go along with it, which I think we'll take that.
I will say if he were to do that, I think it's worth fans, you know, State fans, no matter who it is, being like, hey, regardless if they win or lose, congratulations. That's a really impressive thing. So.
Yeah, good for you. Absolutely.
No. I'm not clapping.
I want to polarize
him.
I'm not telling a Wake fan congratulations at all.
Well,
first of all,
I didn't say tell a fan that. I said tell save a heart.
Wait, hold on. Wake Forest has fans?
Right. Yeah,
exactly.
What?
If you could find
Wake Forest has fans?
Right, only
I don't believe that. Well, and again, it kind of reminds me of 2014. Again, I was when State went to Clemson where we got smoked. I think it was like 42-0, something like that, got shut out. And I remember I was a ball boy on the Clemson sideline. And so for those who don't know, the home side of the field is always where the refs will look when there's a change of possession. So if there's a turnover or if there's a kickoff, the ball will always come from the home sideline. So basically during that game, Vic Beasley broke the Clemson sack record for a career, and he broke it on he actually sacked Jacoby, and Jacoby fumbled it, and then Vic Beasley recovered it, and so we got that ball because the ball came back to us and they put in the Clemson ball. Well, right after that play, a couple of staff members actually came up to me and asked, hey, would you mind if we had that football, you know?
Yeah, we would.
Would you mind if we kept that football? You know, because he just broke the Clemson sack record. And I was like, I mean, I'm not sure. I can't make that decision, but I'll go talk to my boss and get back to you because it happened in the first half. Halftime, when talked to Country, the head equipment manager, and him, he was like, yeah, no, that's cool. And so I ended up giving it to them. And the head equipment manager actually came up to me and shook my hand and said, tell Country, really appreciate that. That really means a lot. Thank you so much. You know, at the end of the day, obviously, does it suck that he broke it against us? But at the end of the day, it's like, listen, you know, it's not like he got all those sacks on us. It's not like he broke the career record of Clemson's sacks against NC State. It's so at the end of the day, it's like, you know, hey, respect where respect is due. Vic Beasley was a beast of a defensive end for Clemson. At the end of the day, Sam Hartman's been a god for Wake Forest, you know, over the last few years. So,
I mean, you're a better man. I would have given him a red nerf football and called it a day.
Yeah, pretty sure this is the one.
This was it.
Totally serious face. Like, what?
What's the problem here?
Yeah.
it makes him a half-chewed
dog toy football.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
Right. This is the one.
Yeah. Yeah, no. But again, the one thing which is kind of crazy, though, is so – not this past week, but the week before, Miami and Duke played, and Duke forced 8 turnovers. So Miami had 8 turnovers, and everybody was like, "Oh my gosh!" Like, I actually broke an NCAA record for the most amount of turnovers in one game. And then a week later, Wake Forest has 8 turnovers against Louisville. And it's like, what is going on in the ACC this year? Holy smokes! And then on top of that, you got freaking Boston College looking terrible. I'm like, and I feel bad.
How do you feel your Zay Flowers? Like, dude, that guy came back for
that. That dude is committed. That dude is the fact that guy hasn't already said he's in the transfer portal. I think says
he's in the NFL portal. Like, he's going.
Yeah. Oh yeah,
no, but if Charles Barkley did football day, like, that's terrible.
That's terrible. Right now.
That's pretty good. I thought somebody said earlier, at least we didn't lose to UConn. Like, Boston College lost to UConn.
And not just lost, pretty they bad. Got pretty much controlled the entire game. Like, it wasn't close.
It was the Chowder Bowl, and Boston College lost. Mm-hmm. They lost their own Chowder Bowl.
Yeah, pretty much.
When you go to a game with a brown paper bag over your head.
I was at the UVA Miami game this weekend, and that was ugly.
Yeah, that was ugly too.
That was one touchdown in 4 quarters plus 4 overtimes. Mm-hmm. And the thing is the game had to end in a touchdown because you go for 2-point conversions.
Right.
So like it was a
touchdown. You had to get in the end zone.
It was only technically a 2-point conversion.
Yeah, technically it's a 2-point conversion. That's fair. But anyway.
Yeah. You know. Again.
So that's true. There was no touchdown scored in that game.
No touchdown.
True.
Ugly. It was so bad.
But again, I mean, it just goes back to, I mean, because again, we, you know, ever so often, you know, we message a little bit with a Fourth and Dude, which is a Boston College podcast we did the preview with last week. I'm sorry, not last week, last year, when we previewed the in-state Boston College game. And I feel for them. I really do. I'm like, golly, like, you know, there was a lot of excitement heading into the season, obviously getting a, you know, second, third year with their new coach, obviously Phil Dracovic coming back, Zay Flowers coming back. And man, just has absolutely blown up in their face. And same thing with Miami too. I mean, Miami was like, "This is our year, baby. This is our year." And
yeah,
I think the best thing they could do. Go ahead.
I don't think they returned a single starter on either offense or defensive line, and that's hard to do.
remember preseason though, when everybody was saying that the ACC has the most star-studded quarterback class, you know, and it's not even close with.
Well, it was the one we weren't thinking about.
Right. Look at most of those guys. Tyler Van Dyke, you know, has been not so much. And then, you know, obviously Malik Cunningham's been so-so. Brennan Armstrong has been god-awful. So
the only one that's been anything is Drake.
Drake.
He wasn't even on the list, though. That's what the point was. He wasn't on the list.
I know. Yeah, Drake Mai, you know, from North Carolina University. So,
DJ's been good, too. I mean, not anything outstanding, but
you shut your mouth.
You shut your mouth, Michael. You shut your dirty mouth.
You shut your mouth when you talk to me.
Yeah, absolutely.
Greatest line from Wedding Crashers.
So, but one thing which we haven't talked about, McLean Hardy brings up, can't explain how great it is to have Trent Penix back on the field. Mm-hmm. Great extra blocker and a huge help on third downs. I mean, obviously, you know, highlighted by the touchdown where, I mean, I think Virginia Tech just plain up forgot about him. And, you know, so for him to get back in the end zone after being out for so long was awesome to see. And again, I mean, that guy is just, he's a Swiss Army knife. I mean, I think he's going to be big. This season,
he's just like Jalen Samuels. He reminds me of Jalen.
Yeah,
in every way.
He's in the light of Jalen Samuels for sure. Now, I mean, there's never going to be another J-Sam. I mean, that dude was a beast within itself, man. That dude was.
He's a close resemblance, but I feel like the Jalen Samuels was more athletic and dynamic with the football in his hands. Not saying Trent Penix isn't. I'm just saying Jalen Samuels was different.
I think Trent is more like a kind of a bowling ball stout guy, where Jalen was more of a shifty guy. Jalen was, you can go east, west, north, south, whereas I think Trent's more of a north, south type kind of guy.
And but, also, I mean, too,
go ahead.
Because J-Sam had an underrated stiff arm, and he also, too, is the greatest of all time at Smack Talk. He was the greatest of all time.
I don't know.
There will never be.
You think he's better than Phillip Rivers?
Philip is different. Philip is different. Let's put it that way. I feel like that.
Shoot, it's
different.
Dang it! Shoot. Darn it!
Dang it!
Yes. No, that's a good point, Greg. Yes, but I would say
I get you. I know you're going.
Dang it!
Very different.
But I think just having Trent back, there was a lot more juice, and he brought a lot more electricity to that offense.
Absolutely,
because I think it was just missing something, right? And so with him back, I think it took him to another level.
Yep. Having him and Demi back on Saturday.
Mm-hmm. Well, hopefully Demi's back. It's not official.
Yeah.
He said he thinks he's back.
The word is expected, but you know, that doesn't necessarily confirm.
No, I will say this. It should be a good thing. There was a picture that was floating around that the team put out, I think, of practice or something. And it was a picture of him in pads.
He was in full pads.
So that's
and no jersey, thing. no yellow jersey, whatever.
But before we get to full, like that hype video last week, when like because of the Halloween theme and Trent being on the tricycle,
yes,
and the lights flickering with like the electricity,
next level.
Yes.
Next level.
I know. Have they announced the jerseys for this week already?
Not yet.
Usually Thursday. But I know two man Wolfpack podcast is all in on the all red hype train.
I think they should do it.
I think they should.
NC State fans would lose their minds if they did all red. They would lose their minds. Which, and again, because keep in mind, I will say this. This is a reminder because, you know, I have a little bit of insight from the all red, you know, topic that there's no doubt Doran is absolutely superstitious. He is 1,000% superstitious.
Is he a little stitious?
He is. He's not a little stitious. He is superstitious. That man, he is definitely superstitious. Again, if he's winning in a certain uniform or a certain helmet, whatever it is, he's going to wear that uniform. He's going to wear that helmet as much as he can. And we lost, I think, 3 or 4 straight games wearing, or not straight games, but just the first 3 or 4 times that Dave Doran wore all red, we lost all of them. And so it was.
Oh, no, I don't want to wear them.
It was that. It was from that point. Dave Doran was like, all right, we're not wearing all red anymore. So, but yet Dave Doran says when that he's asked the question of where does the uniform, you know, combinations come from? He says, oh, the leadership committee, yes, you know, decides, which I'm like, I don't know about that.
I think Doran's got some input.
Well, yeah. He said he has some input. He said he's on a veto.
Yeah.
Well, he can veto. Exactly. Yeah. Well, we want to wear all red. No, all red. No,
I mean, he legit could.
Yeah, I mean, he might have. So, but I mean, I think it looks so clean, though. Yeah, so I'm ready for it. So, again, we'll see what happens. Fingers crossed, all red. We'll love that. But, you know, one thing which we do got to do, kind of running a little bit low on time, but one of the things which Dennis just came in saying, do you think Wake will try and confuse Morris because he's young and inexperienced, showing a bunch of different defenses and shifting? I worry about an interception with Morris. I mean, first thing I got to say that is keep in mind that I think that Wake Forest, I mean, they're coming into the season knowing they're not going to have the best defense and statistically defense so far. They haven't had a good defense. I think, honestly, for them, it's like they're just going to keep it simple and just try and just play their football. I mean, I don't think that they're like that good enough where they could be like, hey, let's do something different, you know, kind of shift things up. Because right now they're just like, hey, listen. Whatever works for us, that's what we're going to do. Yeah. You know, I don't know. But you guys have any thoughts on that?
I mean, I'm sure they'll do something, but.
Sure. I mean, everything.
Not going to be anything like big.
Yeah. Huge. But
just play our game. We just got to play our game.
Exactly. Hey, again, it was great to finally just see the offense be effective.
Together. Yeah.
Fourth quarter offense.
Together. You know, and again, because keep in mind, just like once again, we didn't even play with Demi Sumo.
We finally got that touchdown, too. So now it's.
True.
It was like 120, 130 minutes before we scored a touchdown.
Yep. It was a long time. Now, the one thing which I do got to do here, and because I don't think that this guy has got enough credit, but Jordan Houston, we got to bring him up, man. Like, you know, this play right here, 3rd and 3, less than 2 minutes left, one timeout. So if he gets this, then game's over. Yeah. I mean, the fact that, I mean, Jordan Houston this season has been nothing short of consistent, of reliable, of trustworthy. Again, I mean, I know everybody says he fumbled against ECU on the goal line. Like, you know, how could you say that? Listen, that's one mistake. But ever since then, he has been Mr. 3 to 3.5 yards a rush. He's been he hasn't turned the ball over. He's caught the ball. He's made plays. He has been reliable. So I got to give a shout because everybody's talking about Demi Sumo. I don't think they're talking enough about Jordan Houston and how much, you know, that guy's, you know, not been, you know, flashy, but. He's got the job done.
Yeah,
he's waited his turn.
He's just a steady Eddie. I mean, he just goes out and just does his thing. He's not going to probably blow you away most of the time, but he's just go out and do his job.
He's going to get the job. Yeah. Mm-hmm. He's going to get the job done. Simple.
Yep. Absolutely. And yes, Dennis, so we hope that our fans are off the chain on Saturday too, but we are expecting it. We're not hoping it. We're expecting they're going to be off the chain on Saturday. So anyway, though, but. With that being said, we're going to kind of wrap things up here. So before we announce the winner of the ticket giveaway, again, Michael, myself, and Macon did the NC State vs. Wake Forest preview. So we gave our score predictions during the preview. So if you want to see our predictions, make sure to tune in for those episodes. And to make sure you don't miss out when we release those episodes, again, hit that free subscribe button, hit that free notification bell. So that way you are notified on all your devices whenever we go live with those episodes, and also too whenever we go live for our live shows, and also too since we're heading to basketball season, we're going to be doing some more watch parties you know, during basketball season as well. So make sure you don't miss out on that. All you have to do is just complete those two steps and you won't miss any of it. Simple as that. But Greg and Ken, since they weren't on the preview, I want to hear their predictions. So So Ken's first. Ken's go ahead and say 90-0, and we'll move on to Greg.
Realistically, y'all thought I was going to say we're going to lose. We're not. It's going to be 28-21 State.
Wow, a little bit low scoring. Okay. Greg?
Yeah, I was thinking like 27-24 State.
Yeah. Okay. So still, you know, 52, 51, but okay. Fair enough. So, if you want to see our predictions, Michael's, Makins, and myself's, tune in for those previews. We'll it's definitely a must watch and you will enjoy it for sure. Now, with that being said, once again, first of all, got to give you a huge shout out and thanks once again for everybody who entered and donated towards our Jimmy V fundraiser ticket giveaway, which again includes two tickets to Wake Forest game, a parking pass, opportunity to tailgate with us, food and drinks, you name it, and also an invitation to join us here on the Tuffy Talk live show in a future week. So again, all that together, again, you know, we've raised so far between this year and last year over about $1,100. So thank you all again. But with that being said, we are going to do pick the winner right now, which I am spinning the wheel right now. And the winner is Luis Pulley. Luis Pulley or Lois Pulley, L-O-U-I-S-E, Luis Pulley. So with that being said, if you're here with us, Luis, make sure to direct message us, reach out to us, but we'll try and reach out to you as well to collect your prize. And for those who did enter that did not win, again, I know we have a couple that have been consistently trying to enter into giveaways to win prizes. And to those, I say, you know, as much as I would like to just pick you straight up, you know, just trying to have some ethical to this, you know, just trying to, you know, make it actually random and not just, you know, okay, this person's been waiting a long time, I'm gonna pick it to them. So I mean, you know, it's legitimately off of a random wheel generator which I made, so it's 100% legit.
Y'all can still come tailgate.
You can still come tailgate. Absolutely. Again, every single week, we always drop our location. So again, make sure to join us. And if you join us, we'll definitely give you a drink, give you some food. You know, also we even always have Tuffy Talk gear with us too. So if you want some Tuffy Talk hats, like Ken's, Greg making our sporting. If you want some hats, just come find us at our tailgate, and we'll definitely hook you up. But apologies again for.
The cliffhanger.
For the cliffhanger, yeah. No, I know that was probably the world's biggest cliffhanger ever. And, you know, so we apologize for that. Greg, also, too, just a heads up, you're muted, by the way. I don't know how that happened, but anyway. So while I get that fixed.
I'm back.
Yep, he's back. There we go. So with that being said, once again, just a couple reminders again. So first of all, if you haven't already, again, subscribe. Hit that notification bell and hit that like button. If you think Kansas State's going to win, hit that like button. And that'll signify to us that we have a lot of believers out there. We're going to pull out a huge win here Saturday night in Carter-Finley, 8 p.m.
at the game.
Yes, we're going to be there.
Four you already learned baby. Your lesson.
Or else you're going to get see more mean tweets.
Right? Me and Dave are going to come at you again.
Yeah. but in a much more... You know, here. Come on, y'all, man.
But this time, so. Dave Doran's gonna be the one who tweets it, and McKenzie.
I'm gonna retweet.
Yeah,
Dave Doran, for like, all the guys.
I'm gonna be like incognito, wearing sunglasses, like near Ken's. Like, I don't know who she is. She's crazy.
Right. Yeah.
Greg, you're my ride or die, so you're in it with me.
Facts.
Yeah, absolutely. So, but Dennis says, I believe we can win this thing. Heck yeah, we're gonna win this thing. We got this. And also too, if you haven't already, make sure again to check out our channel memberships. Get only $1.99 a month to get access to all kinds of exclusive Tuffy Talk content. And then lastly, as well, again, if you haven't already, again, give us a follow, Tuffy Talk Now on Twitter or Instagram. We're so excited and ready for 8 p.m. Saturday night. So looking forward to
Don't
it.
Don't forget wrestling Friday night.
Oh, Reynolds. Well, and I haven't even said too. Again, got tomorrow night. You got NC State men's basketball against Lee's McCray, again, exhibition game. So it's going to be exciting to see what this 2022-2023 men's basketball team is going to be looking like. And then on Thursday night, because today's Tuesday, Thursday night, you got women's basketball against UNC Pembroke and Reynolds Coliseum. And both of these things are free, by the way. Doesn't even
free,
cost
free,
anything.
Free.
So, yeah, free, 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 free.
Free, 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 free.
So make sure to again, check those out. And then Friday, You got NC State wrestling versus App
it's
State.
Like $5.
Yep. Again, very, very
five, $7.
You know, yeah, cheap. It's not an expensive ticket whatsoever. So make sure to go check that out. Again, you're going to see a top 10 NC State wrestling team. Hopefully pull off a big win, if not even hopefully a sweep against App State. So again, we'll see what happens with that. Then Saturday, you got it all, baby. So again, these next 4 days are going to be huge. Make sure to check it all out huge. Again, you know, and again, be there, be square. We'll see y'all there. Oh, I like that. That rhymes.
Like
be
that.
There, be there. We'll see y'all.
Just
we'll
end it, Layton. Just end it.
Anyway, Wolfpack Nation. Well, thank you all so much again. Really do appreciate y'all. And again, we'll see y'all here soon. Thank you all again. And go Pack, baby.
Pack, guys.